Portugal sent a 19-year-old girl to Bergen with a fatherless pop song and had big expectations. But hey, the most important thing is not to win, but to participate. And 2 years later, she went again. But hey, yeah, you know what I mean. What has happened since? Why did she leave Portugal for Brazil? And why did she come back? You are listening to your favorite podcast with your fado freak, Emil Löfström. Maestro, please. Welcome to Eurovision Legends, Dora.
Okay, what can I tell you about the 19-year-old girl? I was a perfect stranger here in Portugal. I had never, performed before. My first time was... The first time I ever performed on a live stage was in Norway on the Eurovision Song Contest.
Yes.
Because for that, I was a perfect stranger in Portugal. And I had never done anything towards singing. So here I went. I went to participate in the Portuguese festival. I was a total stranger and I won it. And then I became like a very well-known person in my country. And I recorded with a co-production in England. So I had several records released in English and Portuguese. And yeah. Then what happened is that we had a kind of festival here in Portugal that we called the National Music Prize. And I won. And I won with the song Deja Vu.
Wait. Now you're going too fast. Can we go back to the pre-selection in Portugal?
Okay.
Each of the four Portuguese television districts, Ponta Delgada, Funchal, Porto, yes, and Lisbon, submitted three songs, and the songs were broadcast from these regional studios as video clips. So nothing was live.
We were singing and playing, but it was not like a live show.
Exactly.
Yeah. So all the songs were sent from each TV station, and then a jury decided and presented the song that had won. So it was not like a live show like usually is. It was live in the sense that we were playing live and singing live.
Yeah.
But it was like it was presented separately.
Yes, exactly. And shall we listen to some of your competitors from 1986?
I'd love to. Deixa escorrer um sonho, essa luta antiga que te percorre, rasga suco de bruma, a saudade inútil, livre escondido. Pontes de rostos, não há regresso, o tempo é nosso.
Mas este acordar do seu lado, de não te ter a meu lado, é de enlouquecer.
Yeah, no.
Okay, my Portuguese is not my language, so please help me here. We have just heard que te encontro with Luis Betancourt.
Yeah, he died already. Yeah, okay.
Quebrar a distancia with Sergio Borges.
Quebrar a distancia con Sergio Borges, yes. Very good, your Portuguese is great.
Okay, I love you. Os Tigres de Bengala.
Oh, I love that one.
With
Trabalhadores do Comércio.
Yes.
Well,
yes.
People who work in trading. That's the name of the band. And the song was amazing. I loved it. It was my favorite.
And No Vapor da Madrugada.
Madrugada. Yeah, very good.
With Rimancho. Do you remember these songs?
I remember especially Tigres de Bengala.
Yeah.
Because it was my favorite one. Was from Trabalhadores do Comércio, and I still sing it till today. I loved it. I was a big fan of the group, and especially that one. It's really, really nice.
Who did you see as your biggest threat among the participants?
Well, to tell the truth, I had no idea, because I was the good thing about it is that I was, like David Bowie used to say at the time, I was an absolute beginner. So I thought everyone was better than me, because, you know, I had those people that some of them were already famous, and I don't know, I didn't feel threatened at all. I was just having great time. I went to London for shopping. I was recording. I was like dancing. They put an X on the floor and I would dance all over the place. And they said the camera loved me. So I was just having the time of my life. I didn't really think about the competition. It was like, did I win this thing? You know, I was like 19 years old. I had no idea what was happening. I was just having fun, that's all.
Jerry chose you to represent Portugal. Do you remember your reaction? I mean, was this a scenario that even existed?
Not really. I remember that I had already been quite exposed, because at the time, Festival was a huge event here in Portugal. The country would stop to watch it. And there were only two TV channels. So you can imagine, and all the press and everything. So I was already, you know, a little bit overwhelmed with all the things. And then I won.
Yeah.
I knew I had won. I was like, oh my God, do you think they would come here? I was knocking at my door or something. I was so afraid. I was really afraid. I was not the best person. No one taught me how to deal with, what happened after that was good, but it was hard at a certain level.
The contest in 1986 was held in Bergen, since Bobby Sox won the year before. And before we talk about your participation there, can you take us back to your memories from Norway?
Oh, I loved it. I thought, oh my God, are all the men like that?
Boys. Boys.
Tall and blonde. And I was like this, you know, I'm Portuguese, so I'm not so tall. I'm a brunette, and all the guys were blonde. I had blue eyes, and I was like, oh my God, what is this? <It's> like, and I really loved Norway. Bergen is beautiful. I remember staying at a hotel with some other delegation, especially the Greek delegation. She was really, really nice. And we went on a ship to visit the fjords.
Wait. Greece didn't participate.
No, Cyprus, I think it was. Yeah. Cyprus, yes, I'm sorry. She was not Greek. Oh my God, this is...
Elpida, but you know what? She is Greek.
Well, I was kind of... Because I talked to her and she told me she was Greek.
Yeah.
So, you know, people from Greece and from Cyprus won't be happy if I say this, but I really thought she was from Greece. But no, she was from Cyprus, and she was lovely, lovely. And it was the best time, really.
Do you remember anything special that happened behind the scenes that you can share with us?
Well, I remember the maestro that was going to perform with us.
Yeah.
His name was Colin something. I can't really remember his last name. It was English. And I remember something he used to tell me, like before the presentation and during the rehearsals, he used to say, be good. If not, be careful. I'll never forget that.
Greece withdrew from the contest, so 20 countries took part, and you were drawn to be the final act. How was it for your nerves to be the last entry?
Well, to tell you, I think I was very nervous, but at the same time, like I told you, and I know this is a hard thing to believe, but if you knew me, like in person, you wouldn't understand. I am a very like head on clouds person, and I was like having the greatest time. I took my boyfriend there. I was with all the delegation, my friends. They were my friends and the musicians. So I had no idea what kind of responsibility I had on my shoulders. I was singing for the king of Norway, and you know, yeah, all the Eurovision people on TV, and it was okay. I loved my outfit. I was with my Doc Martens, and I know I just went and had fun. That's all.
Please tell us about your edgy styling with puffy hair and equally puffy dress and big clunky boots.
Well, I have to tell you, I owe all this to a Portuguese stylist that he lived in London and he studied at the St. Martin's.
Yeah.
And so he was very edgy, and he was like avant-garde here in Portugal at the time. So my boots, they were Doc Martens. My skirt was from the American Classics, was one of those 50 skirts that the girls would wear beneath the dresses for, you know, to hold them and to make them swing as they curl dancing.
Yeah, exactly.
And my jacket was made of some kind of silk. It was black. It was hand tailored for me, and I had something that we call an astrolabio, which is an instrument of navigation from the Portuguese. The Portuguese people that went across the seas and discovered like a large part of the world, they had this instrument called astrolabio. I don't know how to say that in English. So it was a Portuguese symbol. And my hair had like had pieces that were orange, green, purple, and my hair was curled at the time. So they just let it, and that was it. In my country, you know, I have to tell you, it was a whole new world for Dr. Martens, like Thierry something that made the comments for Britain. But I was almost crucified here in my country.
Ooh.
Because Portugal was very serious. So how could I have worn that thing to the Eurovision Song Contest? And like 2 years afterwards, all the teenagers would have like some boots like mine, would wear Levi jeans 501, and you know, was a trend setting, but it was painful here, really.
Well, looking on it today, I think it still look modern.
Well, I hope so. I really love it. And it was this Ventura Bell. He, after I stopped, I didn't buy the clothes, he would like designed them for me, and he was very, very avant-garde for his time here. And well, it was like a transcending, but until today, I think people here in Portugal remember it. It's amazing. It's like 35 years ago, and they still remember how I dressed. And I can't even remember what I ate yesterday. So it was like amazing, you know. It was very funny, very, very funny.
Who did you see as your biggest competitor in Norway?
Well, I think it was that little girl. That Sandra Kim. Yeah, we knew as she sang, we knew she would win that because she was like cute and she was a good singer. And well, I thought she would win, really. And she did.
Was that your personal favorite too?
Well, I liked Cyprus, like I told you.
Yeah. They ended last.
I know. Life can be unfair, and we know that about Eurovision.
Yes.
So, anyway, but I liked Sandra Kim. I really did.
Yeah, and she won. Switzerland got second place. Luxembourg yes. Came third. Ended in our 14th place with 28 points.
Yes, yes.
Opinions about the outcome?
Well, we never expected to win, really. So we just won like 3 or 4 years ago after almost half century of the Eurovision. So it's not like we were... I was really happy because it was my first time. I had no career. I was a total stranger in my country. And there I went to... the Eurovision, I sang for the king and all the Eurovision community, and I ended up in like the 14th. So, oh my God, that's great. It's okay.
You release an English version of the song. Do you yes. remember the title?
Oh, I do. It was so bad. Don't make me say it. Please.
Okay.
It's embarrassing.
Okay, we will play the song now. You are hurting me.
Yeah. Well, I don't know why they, you know, they could like have adapted, not literally translating the thing. So, but okay, whatever. It is what it is. So it's okay.
The poor result in 1986 didn't affect your career in your home country, and several hit singles was released.
Yes.
And
yes.
Among them, my personal favorite is Jade.
You know, I really love that song. And then it was also chosen at the time. Famous people doing backing tracks for famous products worldwide, like Sun Silk shampoos and stuff. And it was a really well-played song. It was one of my hits here.
Yeah.
It was really nice.
Baby, don't you lie to me. You are my fantasy. You're my one and only. Baby, don't you lie.
Favorite track yourself?
Yes, I do. And it's called Our Love. It's my favorite one.
When I think of all the good times that we had, the things that we've been through, it makes me sad, it makes me blue, 'cause no one's gonna love you the way. You know it's true. How
a thousand years. Go through the edges and through the fears.
And 17. I don't know, because our love, I love it because it's a really beautiful ballad. And 17, I think, is my favorite because it's totally about me. Yeah, it's my story. Yeah, kind of.
Would you believe if that was magic? Hey, and things turn out the way you wanted to. Would you believe you could be happy when all the world was you?
In 1988, you took part again in the Portuguese selection to Eurovision. Tell
yes.
me, how did this come about?
Well, I was supposed to go with Deja Vu, and then the Portuguese TV invited me to go with another song. So I had to go, and I did. And I have sang that song like 3 times in my life, and that was it.
Okay, we rewind the tape, and let's listen to Deja Vu.
Amare Paris, deixar uma lágrima. Voltar a fazer amor sem remédio. Ai, sentir romance no ar. Vestir os lábios de mel e ser prazer. Fazer um filme nos braços de um Romeu. Deja vu, deja vu. Não há que inventar, tudo é deja vu, deja vu.
Oh, I love that one.
Yes, me too. This is a smash hit.
That is a song that should have gone there, you
yeah.
know? Because that's my song. The other one was like, I was hired to sing that, so.
In the pre-selection, 8 songs compete in the semi-final, and why not listen to some of your competitors from this pre-selection?
Okay.
Não vês que estou aqui, louco de amor por ti. Ou pensas em outra alguém? Morena linda, cabelos ao vento, daria tudo só por um momento. Uma noite ao teu lado, acordar abraçado, te deixar dormir.
We have just heard Uma Noite ao Teu Lado.
Ao Teu Lado, very good.
With Antonio Antunes.
You know Antonio Antunes is now Tony Carreira,
okay.
which is a very, 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 very famous Portuguese singer now.
Oh.
Romantic singer, yeah. So at the time he was living in France.
Yeah.
And he came here and he lost. And now he's like one of the most rich and famous Portuguese singers here.
Cool. I liked his song in this pre-selection. That was pretty good.
Yeah, it was quite danceable, I think. Yeah, it was
yeah.
nice.
And we had Amazonia with Midos.
Oh, yeah, Amazonia. I know that one. Yeah.
And Porte Querer Azim with Tulial.
Tulial, oh, I love that guy. He's my friend. And He's a very good singer, and nowadays he works in musical theater with Tolial. Yeah, he's a really nice guy and a very talented artist.
Your song Deja Vu won.
Yes.
But as we know, that song did not compete in Eurovision. So why did they change the song?
Well, I would say that they made me an offer I couldn't refuse.
Okay.
Like The Godfather, So that's all I'll say. I had performed on a demo that song by the request of the organizer of the semifinal that I won with Deja Vu.
Yeah.
And for as long as I knew, Deja Vu was going to the Eurovision because I had won. And then they presented the demo I had recorded as the song that was going to the Eurovision. So no more I can say, no more shall I say. So, you know, made me an offer I couldn't refuse, like in The Godfather.
I understand. In 1988, a trip went to Ireland. How was Dublin?
Yes. Oh, lovely. It was lovely. I already knew Johnny Logan, and I was a huge fan of him. And I loved Ireland. Ireland is a very magical place. And of course, there was Celine Dion there. There was Lara Fabian there. I mean, there were all these amazing singers. And was really lovely. It was really, really lovely.
Did anything happen there that you remember that you can share with us?
Yes, I remember I got sick like 2 days before the competition. I had a sore throat because of the air conditioner or something. I don't really know. And it was a little bit of a rush because I had to take medicine and everything. Like, I was really worried. I was really worried because the song had been changed. The original song was a really beautiful ballad with the powerful chorus, and that was it. And it was really nice because most of the song was piano and voice, and then it grew at the end. And then the maestro rearranged the song, and it was like chorus from the beginning to the end.
Yeah.
So it was like running a marathon for me.
Yeah.
And I remember I was really worried because I was sick, but then in the end I managed to sing it.
Funny you said before that you had sung that song three times, because I found three different versions of this song.
Yeah, well, the original one, I really liked it.
Já não estou onde tu estás, procurando outro lugar. Talvez na lua ou no mar da minha cama. Um, dois, três, vou começar. É a minha vez de jogar, mas só para não te encontrar vou perder. Vejo que tenho outro amor para pôr no teu. Agora fica a ganhar por dois a um. Sem ti, mas fiquei sem ti. Por te amar.
Yeah, and that was the one that you sent out to the TV stations in Europe as a music video.
Yes.
Yeah.
And then when I got there, he decided he had changed. He would change. Well, he has already passed away, so I'm saying this with the utmost respect. But he decided he rearranged the song.
Yeah.
And okay, I had to do it. But for me, I never did. During the time of my career that I had to sing the song, I would always sing the original version. I would never sing the Eurovision version as it was presented. Because it was not the song that I was meant to sing, and then it was not the way it was meant to be sang. So no more shall I say about Dublin. You know,
21 countries competed this year, and you did not perform last this time, but second to last.
Yes, and I ended almost last. I think before last, the last one before the last. I don't know. I have no idea.
Yeah,
but it was bad.
Yeah, you ended in an 18th place with 5 points.
Yeah, it was bad. But, well, it was bad not for me because I didn't sing badly. And it was like amazing singing with that amazing orchestra. But it was, you know, I told you so for some people, you know.
Yeah.
That changed everything.
So.
what was the big difference between 1986 and 1988, would you say, besides the outcome?
Well, the big difference, at least for me, is that in 1986, everything was magical and I was an absolute beginner. And that song was me, the way I dressed, the way I was on stage, everything was like far more genuine than it was on 88, in 1988, even though it was always an honor and a responsibility to represent my country. And I was really proud of being chosen, but things were not, how shall I say this, were not like the way they were meant to be, at least in my perspective at that time.
We must talk about your outfit. On stage you wear a cream-colored dress and braided hair. Quite a big difference from last time. This outfit wasn't puffy at all.
No, not at all. And it was not cream. It was like a slightly oranged fire, as with like salmon, depending on the lights. They wanted to give me a more grown-up look.
Yeah.
So it was a whole different wardrobe. It was another proposal. It was like someone that had grown up a little and more like a silhouette thing. All the wardrobe for the occasion was different, more sophisticated, and the hair was more sober and everything. So it was just another adventure, I would say.
In a puffy dress and puffy hair, Celine Dion won.
Yes, but she won because, you know, she's Celine Dion. I still remember that song, and I still sing that her song, and I'm a huge fan of her. I was not a particular fan of her hair or her outfit, but I was blown away by her singing, so she won, yeah.
How did you react to the result there and then?
Well, from where I see it now, like, you know, 30 years after, I think I told you so for the other ones. It didn't harm me here. Because everyone knew that something had happened and that Deja Vu was the song that was supposed to go. So it didn't harm my career. But it harmed the reputation of other people that were involved in the project.
Portugal struggled hard in Eurovision. And besides Salvador Sobral's victory in 2017, sixth place is the best result since your country's debut in 1964. Why do you think Portugal has a hard time in Eurovision?
Well, I'm going to give you the politically correct answer. I think it's probably about different tastes or something. Because if I would give you the answer of what I really think, I think I performed in a show that was called The B-Side of the Eurovision. And I mean, everyone knows that there are political and economical things behind results and stuff. So I don't really know. It's the best way, the best answer, the safest answer I can tell you.
Shortly after your second time in Eurovision, you moved to Brazil.
I moved to Brazil in, was not after, I still performed in a play and I went to the OT festival in Las Vegas, Latin American and Iberian festival. And then I went to Brazil. Yes, I got married to a Brazilian and I was kind of tired of being, I don't know, it can be very lonely when you don't have like the right team or the right structure. So I chose to live a different life, basically.
We must talk about the Playboy magazine, please. I saw the pictures last week. Beautiful and brave.
Oh my God. You know what? That was like a conquest for me because I was always very, I had a lot of complexes with my body because I wasn't skinny enough or because I worked out all my life. I was a dancer. I practiced gymnastics, and so I was always very athletic. And I was never that, you know, that really round shaped body. That I was never that. So at the age of 46, I was 46 years old then. They invited me And I thought, well, I felt confident about my body. I prepared myself and everything. And I thought, why not? I mean, women can be, you don't have to be 20 to be sexy, because sensuality or beauty can be, you know, can cut across all generations. You know, all people have their own beauty. All ages have their own sensuality. And it was like just to show that after 3 kids and 46 years old, you can still be sexy. You can still be powerful. I mean, for all, it was like an empowering thing for women, I think.
Amen.
Okay.
Many industries have a very tough times these days, not at least the music industry. And when I did my research, I noticed that you took a job at McDonald's in 2014.
Yes, yes.
And I think that such flexibility is honorable and shows that you don't consider yourself too good for a regular job. Or how did your thoughts go at the time?
Well, I can tell you at the time and now, I believe that the best way to survive in a happy way is to be like water. You have to be flexible. You have to look at things and not make such a big drama out of it. I mean, if you're healthy and you are in like in, you don't have work is not coming, you do other things. At the time, I worked at McDonald's. Now, because of the pandemic, I don't know, I was working with children at a school with artistic expression and dance lessons and everything. I don't have that problem. I am a very flexible person when it comes to surviving. I am not rich. I was never. So I have no problem on, you know, on doing other things. I don't know why people made such a fuss about it. Really, I don't. Because it's an honorable job. It's not like I'm stealing or smuggling drugs or anything. I was working at McDonald's. Like I worked at a bar afterwards. Like I'm working, not presently because the school is closed, I'm working at a school, but I'm still singing. You know, I don't know why people have to be like so, have that kind of prejudice. I mean, we're just people, like, you know, we're all equal. We all need to live and pay our bills. And we're not too good for doing anything that doesn't dishonor us. So that's my view.
I totally agree. And what a role model you are for your children.
Yes, I'm fierce with my kids. You know, I have this saying in Portuguese, it's different, but no one plays with my kids' food. And it's kind of like that. I mean, my kids are everything. And I believe that when you have responsibilities, you have to go over sometimes the things that you wanted to for yourself or that you wanted to do. If you go either way, it's better for the family. You should do that.
What are you doing today in your life?
Well, like I told you, it's coming the anniversary of Não Seja Mal Para Mim, so I am performing at some TV shows. I have been working at a school with kids, teaching artistic expression like theater, singing, dancing. So I've been a teacher.
Yeah.
Which I had already been, and basically is that because there are no shows, there the theaters. I worked for the last 5 years in a musical theater with Philippe Laferri, which is a very well-known producer here, and now everything is stopped, so I had to figure out a way to survive. I still sing when I can, and I really hope to go back to the theater when everything goes back to normal. But for now, I have been teaching.
Thank you so much for this nice chat, Dora.
Well, I thank you so much, too. I'm so sorry for some technical difficulties that we had. But it was lovely. This trip back to the past was really lovely. Thank you. Thank you so much.
And thanks to you, our listeners out there in the world. I hope you enjoyed this chat with me and Dora. And if you did, subscribe, like, and write a review and tell everyone you know about Eurovision Legends. You find Eurovision Legends on Facebook and Instagram and all information on my website, eurovisionlegends.se. What do you say, Dora? Shall we end this conversation with your favorite song, Déjà Vu?
Oh, yes, please. It will be an honor. Thank you. Take care. God bless you. Bye.